So thank you for the introduction, and thanks to the organizer for organizing this nice conference. So more specifically, I will speak about logarithmic subreflex inequalities, and in a second time, I will focus on the Heisenberg group. So yeah, I will first give a review, and like some kind of panorama about logarithmic subreflex inequalities, why they are useful, why you want to study them. Then I will give a short overview of the proof of Gross, which in my opinion is very nice and people should know about it. And in last time I will speak about log subreflex inequalities on the Heisenberg group. So first I will give you a short bibliography of this talk is based on few things. So the article of Gross from 1975, which is the original one. Then a paper of Bakri and Emery, which is in French, but I mean, if you can read French, you should read it, it's very interesting. Then one book by many students of Toulouse, Anne, Blacher, Chaffay, and so on, about logarithmic subreflex inequalities, also in French. A survey by Ledoux, so if you cannot read French, you can read this survey, which is in English, which is basically the same as the article of Bakri-Emery, but more polished and more precise. Then you have this very big book by Bakri, Gentil, and Ledoux. And then you have an article by Bonnefond, Chaffay, and myself, where we study logarithmic subreflex inequalities on the kernel. Okay, so I will start. So the setting is the setting of Markov process. So I have time homogeneous Markov process. And from this process, I can define an operator PT that acts on functions. So I integrate my function against the transition kernel. And if you prefer the probabilistic representation, I take the expected value of F evaluated at xt, knowing that x0 is x. Okay. And I have two assumptions on my Markov dynamic. So the first one is reversibility. So there exists a probability measure mu such that the following equation is satisfied. So this is not the most general setting in which I can state my result, but I mean it's easier like that. And the second one is the Feller property. So you can easily verify that if you take t equals 0 in the definition of pt, p0 of f is f, but I want a stronger property, namely that it converges in L2 of mu as t goes to 0. Okay. So you can check immediately two properties of this operator PT. The first one is the semi-group property. So that PT plus S is PT PS. And this is why it's called Markov semi-group in general. And the second one is the contraction property, meaning that PT maps LP to LP. It's a linear operator and its norm is smaller than 1. Okay. So this is the immediate consequence of Jensen inequality and the reversibility. But people want to know more. Okay, so in the 70s, people from quantum field theory start to ask, can we improve this contraction property? Okay, for instance, can I have the norm of PT from L2 to L4 smaller than 1 for some t positive? Okay. So of course, if t equals 0, this cannot be true, so it's for some t positive, it cannot be true immediately, but after some time, does my semi-group improve the integrability of my function? Okay. So I won't give a more detailed definition of hypercontractivity, but the idea is that you win integrability after some times. Okay. So to state some result about hypercontractivity, I will need some more definition. So, okay. Probably most of you are familiar with this, but I repeat it because I want to be clear. So the first is the term by Yoshida about the so-called generator of the semi-group. So this says that I can somehow take the time derivative of the semi-group at t equals 0. Okay, so it gives me an unbounded generator, but with a dense domain, and the domain is stable by the action of the semi-group. Okay. And if you want, this generator solves the abstract heat equation I wrote. So I will give a few examples in two slides, I think. So if you lost, you can keep on that. And I will define three other objects. So the first one is called the carré du champ. Even in English, it's called like that. which somehow measure the lack of how far L is a derivation, okay? So you see, if L was like the standard derivation, the correlation would be zero. But in general, it's not a derivation. So it measures how far it is from a derivation. And once I have this correlation, I can define a Dirichlet energy by integrating the correlation against mu. And by reversibility, I can see it's also minus the integral of f times Lg, or g times Lf. And I also define the iterated carré du champ, or carré du champ itéré, I don't know. Okay. So it's the same definition as the carré du champ, where I replace the product by the carré du champ. Okay, so you see, in the definition of the carré du champ, you have L of Fg. Here I have L of gamma Fg. Okay. So you have these three objects. And you will see an example what it values. But first, I will define what is the Lochsobleff inequality in this abstract setting. So I say that my semigroup satisfies logarithmic Sobleff inequality if the quantity on the left is bounded by the Dirichlet energy times the constant. Okay. So the quantity on the left is called the entropy, or probabilistic entropy. And on the right, the Dirichlet energy. And why people are interested by that? If you remember this hyperconductivity problem, it's because if you satisfy a Lochsobleff inequality, then you are hyperconductive. Okay. So this is a theorem in the initial article of Gross, and in the paper of Bakri-Emery, they give more sufficient and necessary conditions for hyperconductivity based on like variation of logarithmic Sobleff inequality. Okay. So now I will give like the canonical example. So I take the Hochstein-Uhlenbeck dynamic on the line. So basically, just a drifted Brownian motion. Okay. So it's very easy to compute that the invariant measure is the standard Gaussian. I have an explicit formula for the semigroup, which is a Mellor formula. So I just integrate f along this Gaussian. Okay. The generator is given by minus twice the derivative of f, the second derivative of f plus x times the first derivative of f. So you see, I have a part which is a derivation and a part which is like a second order. So when I compute the carré du champ, only the second order term counts. So I have this product of the derivative, and I can also explicitly compute the iterated carré du champ. Okay. So to compute the generator, you can just apply Itô formula, for instance. Okay. Well, and so the other main theorem of the paper of Gross I already cite is that this semigroup satisfies a logarithmic Sobleff inequality, and therefore it is hyperconstructive. Okay. So what does it mean? It means that the entropy of every function with respect to the Gaussian measure is bounded by twice times the integral of the derivative of f squared. Okay. So maybe like a remark, why is it called Lochsobleff inequality? You know that usually Sobleff inequality tells you that you can bound like a LP norm by a norm in a Sobleff space. And here it's the L log L norms that you bound by a Sobleff norm. Okay. Hence the name. So I will give you a very short overview of the proof by Gross. So first, what you do is that you prove a logarithmic Sobleff inequality for a very simple Markov dynamic, which is a Markov dynamic of a two-point space with invariant measure one-half of your two-point. Like you just jump from point to point with one-half. So it's very easy to prove a logarithmic Sobleff inequality because in this case, it's even an equality. Because everything is very straightforward to compute, so you have an equality. And then the second main ingredient is like you prove like a tensorization property of your Lochsobleff inequality. I mentioned Sobleff inequality. Probably you remember that they really depend on the dimension. I mean, on R2 and on R3, the constants are not the same. For logarithmic Sobleff inequalities, they are dimension-free, meaning that you can go from dimension to dimension and you stay, I mean, the constant doesn't change. So if my measure nu satisfies a logarithmic Sobleff inequality, nu tensor nu will also satisfy a logarithmic Sobleff inequality with the same constant. And so I can iterate and obtain a logarithmic solution equality for new n with the same constant as before. Okay. And then what I do is I invoke the central limit theorem. I push forward by the average, and I invoke the central limit theorem, and I will converge to the Gaussian. Okay. So the central limit theorem tells you that so that this converges in law towards the Gaussian. In particular, if I take like a Bernoulli random variable, it works. So it works. And so you just have to prove some stability of logarithmic sublife inequality with respect to the limit, but it's not so complicated. And this is the end of the proof. Okay. So it's a very, it's a very, very nice proof. And the idea of I want to present is that you can adapt this proof to the setting of the Heisenberg group, and it will still work up to some modification that I will explain. So, So before I move on the Heisenberg group, one slide for people who like Riemannian geometry. I don't know if there are many in this room, but so if I replace the Markov dynamic by a more general dynamic on a weighted manifold, like I have a potential V on a manifold, a Brownian motion on a manifold, and I take this dynamic, you have the invariant measure, which is given by exponential of minus v times the volume measure. The generator is still explicitly computable. So here, delta is the Laplace-Beltrami operator. And nabla is a Riemann gradient. You have a formula for the carré du champ, which involves only the gradient. And you have a formula for the iterated carré du champ, which involves the second derivative, the first derivative, as before, but also the Ricci curvature. Okay. So if you don't know what is the Ricci curvature, it's not so important. But I just want to quote this theorem from Bakri-Emery that says that you satisfy logarithmic sublife inequality if the Ricci tensor plus the second derivative of the potential is bounded below by a positive constant. Okay. And so what motivated to study the logarithmic sublife inequality on the Heisenberg group is that, as I will explain, the Ricci curvature of the Heisenberg group is minus infinity. So this strategy from Bakri-Emery cannot be applied directly to the Heisenberg group. So we need a different approach. Okay. So now I move on the Heisenberg group. So the Heisenberg group, it's a Lie group, so I can define it by this Lie algebra. So I have three generators in the Lie algebra and one relation. So the relation is the commutator of x and y is equal to z. Okay. And I can realize the Lie group of this Lie algebra as R3 with a different group law. So it's written here. So you see on the two first coordinates, it's a standard law on R2. And on the last coordinate, I'll have like addition of z plus something which is like some sort of determinant. Okay. So what is it? Is that somehow moving in H is like moving on R2, on R2, plus you keep track of the area you moved in. Okay. So if you start from 0, you move to 0, 1. Okay. So it's 0, 0, 0. You have 1, 0, 0. And when you move here, you have like 1, 1, 1 half, because you have the area of what is below here. Okay. So automatically, the last coordinate computes the area of how far you went. Okay. And you can give also a basis of the tangent space given by this vector field. Okay. So, and you can immediately verify that this vector field satisfies the commutation relation that you want. Okay. So now a bit of geometry of this group. So I will say that a path on the Heisenberg group is horizontal if its derivative belongs to the subspace of the tangent space generated by my two first coordinates x and y. Okay. And for such a path, I say that the length of the path that I note LH is this energy. Okay. Okay. And there is a theorem, a general theorem, that says that the Heisenberg group is path connected with the horizontal path, meaning that I can always connect two points in my group with a horizontal path. And once I have this theorem, I can define a distance on the Heisenberg group, which is called the Carnot-Karatoori distance, by taking the infimum of all the lengths of paths which are horizontal and that connect my two points. Okay? So this gives like a metric structure on the Heisenberg group, but it's kind of weird because from the algebraic point of view or topological point of view, H is R3, okay? But it has Hausdorff dimension 4. Okay? So it's kind of weird object. Clearly it's not a Riemannian manifold, and it's a sub-Riemannian manifold. And so people try to understand more what happened on such object. And I also define two sub-Riemannian operator, which is the Nabla, sub-Riemannian Nabla, which is just x and y, and the sub-Riemannian Laplacian, which is just x squared plus y squared. Okay? Any question, maybe? Okay, so now I can consider the Hochstein-Lembeck dynamic on the Heisenberg group. So in the two first coordinates, I put a Brownian motion, because you remember on the two first coordinates, I have like the canonical standard addition, so it's just the Brownian motion. And on the last coordinate, I put the Lévy area. Okay. So you remember the heuristic I gave, like how you remember the group encodes the area. So this is how I do it. So this defines me the Brownian motion on the semigroup, and from this I can define the Hochstein-Lembeck operator as before. So it's here, and I call gamma h the law of H1. Okay, so this is the Gaussian law on the Heisenberg group, if you want. I can compute explicitly the different operators I gave, like L, carré du champ, interdit carré du champ, but I don't really need it. And as I said, the Ricci curvature is minus infinity. Okay, and so we cannot use the result of Bakri-Emery, but what we can do is we can use the idea of Gross, because it's a group, so you still have a central limit theorem, and we can derive a twisted logarithmic sublef inequality, which is written here. So you see, you have the entropy on the left, you have twice the energy on the right, so this is good, this is what you want ideally, but you have this reminder term, and okay, so this, but I mean, this is what we have, so okay. So this is what we obtain, so this is all I wanted to say, so thank you, and yeah, so the idea of the proof is the same, and okay, I finish here.
Some other questions?
Thank you. I didn't know that it was possible to use this inequality, these ideas in the context of negative curvature. And is it possible to do so when you have surfaces, for instance, a quotient of the hyperbolic plane by a subgroup, and because there are spectral gaps, but I didn't know that it could be deduced from techniques like that.
Okay, so this is very particular to the structure of the Heisenberg group, because we need the central limit theorem to apply the proof. So we need a group structure in order for this to work. Mm-hmm. And also, it's not a real logarithmic sublef inequality, because we have this second term on the right, which is a remainder term. So ideally, we want this to be zero, but it's not possible, because we know by the Bakri-Emery theory that if it satisfied a true logarithmic sublef inequality, it would have a rich curvature bounded below. So this is not the case. So it's not a true logarithmic sublef inequality, but we can still derive something. For a quotient of the hyperbolic group by something, you have a theory which was developed by Bonnefond, Baudouin, and Garofalo, based on the Bakri-Emery strategy. So maybe it applies in this case, but I don't know. Like they sort of complete the carré du champ with another operator, and they can prove inequality like that.
Yes, it's a recent work.
Yeah, I think like 2014 or something like that.
Also a question. I have a question. So
yes.
Can you explain what does this remainder term measure or?
Yeah, okay. So I was very quick, but yeah. So as you see, I have a closed formula from this. Okay, I will write because the pointer doesn't work. So it's like that. So this ZF is in some sense it measures something in the vertical direction, in the direction I don't want to see. And it arises because somehow the increments are non-commutative. So when I take derivative in the sum of the central limit theorem, depending on where I am in the increment, I have different results. So this is why it appears. And as you see, the A involves the this is the quadratic variation. Like this integral is the quadratic variation of the Brownian motion. So, and this is very particular to the Eisenberg group. You could do similar computation or other Lie groups, but the fact that everything simplifies in this way is really due to the fact that the Eisenberg group is a rank two group, meaning that I just take one Lie bracket and I generate my whole algebra. But yeah, I mean, it's not clear for us what means this inequality really. I mean, we were not able to do concentration of measure with it, for instance, or something like that. Usually you can deduce concentration of measure from logarithmic solvability, but in this case, no. So.